Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open, all desires are open,
and from whom no secrets are hidden, bend
the thoughts of our hearts
by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Welcome everyone to this Eucharist on the feast of St. Luke the Evangelist. A particular welcome to our preacher this evening, Canon Stephen Edwards, who's come to us from Worcester Cathedral. So we give thanks for the example of St. Luke's life, in his writings, and the ways in which he pointed people to Christ. Let us call to mind those ways in which we have failed to live sacrificially in the service of Christ and our neighbour, following Luke's example, as we call to mind our sins. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Thank you.
peace, let us pray. Almighty God, you called Luke, the physician, whose praise is in the Gospel, to be an evangelist and physician of the soul. By the grace of the Spirit, and through the wholesome medicine of the Gospel, give your Church the same love and power to heal. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
A reading from the second letter of Paul to Timothy. As for you, always be sober, enduring suffering, do the work of an evangelist, seek out your ministry fully. As for me, I am always being called out as a libation. The time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Do your best to come to me soon, for Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Crescena has gone to Galatia, Titus to Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is useful in my ministry. I have sent Tychicus to Ephesus. When you come, bring the cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas, also the books, and above all, the parchments. Alexander the coppersmith did me great harm. The Lord will pay him back for his deeds. You also must beware of him, for he strongly opposed our message. At my first offense, no one came to my support, but all deserted me. May it not be counted against them. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. according to Luke.
Glory to you, God.
The Lord appointed 70 other disciples and sent them on ahead of him in pairs to every town and place where he himself intended to go. He said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter, first say, 'Peace to this house.' And if anyone is there who shares in peace, your peace will rest on that person. But if not, it will return to you. Remain in the same house, eating and drinking whatever they provide, for the laborer deserves to be paid. Do not move about from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and its people welcome you, eat what is set before you. Cure the sick who are there, and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.'" This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. It really is a joy to be with you this evening for this Feast of St. Luke, and I feel especially blessed because this is my second invitation in 1 year to this college chapel. Of course, I wasn't able to fulfill my first invitation here because of this incredibly different year. But it really is a joy to be here now as you begin this term and on this very particular occasion. So I'm grateful to Dr. Jones for the invitation to preach for you this evening. One of my predecessors at Worcester Cathedral, the residentary canon about 100 years ago, was the incessantly active James Wilson. He arrived at Worcester at the age of 70 and he retired at the age of 85. He said he did his best work after the age of 80. On his arrival, the dean, who had heard of Canon Wilson's energy as a mathematician, an astronomer, a schoolmaster, social reformer, priest, and archdeacon, was obviously very concerned that life was going to be very different. There was going to be a radical change at the cathedral. And he was concerned, and he greeted the new canon by saying, "There was nothing to do, and nothing that ever wanted doing." Of course, the dean was speaking of cathedral life in a different era. 100 years ago, cathedrals were generally quieter, certainly very different institutions from what they are now. The dean really didn't want things to change. His fears were a worry that the peace and tranquility and hitherto normality, as he knew it, of the cathedral precincts was about to be disturbed by a flurry of activity, and worst of all, a flurry of evangelism. Although I have no formal title as residentary canon at Worcester Cathedral, mission and evangelism are part of my portfolio. And so on the Feast of St. Luke, physician and evangelist, I feel I have no option but to disturb us into thinking at least a little about evangelism. Before arriving at Worcester, I spent the last 7 years of my time in Manchester as team rector of a team of four parishes, four churches, one of which was dedicated to St. Luke. It was dedicated definitely to St. Luke the physician. This definitive attribute to Luke meant that most sermons on their patronal festival would always centre on the church's ministry of healing and reconciliation and wholeness. And as I think back, that was really ironic because of all the churches in the team, St. Luke's the physician was almost the most evangelical of the churches. And yet, the epic journeys of Luke with Paul and Luke as a gospel writer rarely got a mention. It was always about healing. Healing trumped evangelism. It was as if the two portfolios were mutually exclusive. But of course, evangelism is a form of healing. Salvation is the triumph of all healing. And this is clear from the scriptures, it's clear from church tradition, and most importantly, it's clear from our own experiences of our encounters with God. And yet I make no attempt to hide the fact that I have been formed in a tradition where evangelism really was at the bottom of the list for much of my training, and perhaps I'm ashamed to say my ministry. It's not something that I am often comfortable with. The word is one that I shy away from. For some, the energy of evangelism has ridden roughshod over deeply held, beautifully understood, authentic experiences of encounter with the saving presence of Christ. And for many of us, perhaps, we have an experience of evangelism as a rather blunt tool in the hands of the untrained or unskilled. St. Luke has a delightfully paradoxical status as being amongst the least mentioned and yet the most present in the New Testament. His name only appears twice in the scriptures, and yet his presence is, of course, very keenly felt. His writings span almost a quarter of the New Testament, and his missionary journeys with Paul are peppered so much with the word we that even though he's not named, Luke is a constant presence. He is off-center, but he is there. The selection of readings tonight rightly includes a reading from the Gospel according to Luke, and I could have chosen as the first reading a reading from the book of Acts, which of course he wrote, and that would have contained that characteristic word we, Luke there, but not named, just present. But I didn't choose the Acts, I chose this wonderful reading from the second letter of Timothy for two reasons. Firstly, it's perhaps the most tenuous of all links with Luke. It's one of the two passages where his name is mentioned. Only Luke is with me. I wonder at people who create lectionaries and calendar readings, because it seems an odd one at first reading. It just mentions Luke, let's stick it in and see if anyone notices. But the second reason I chose it was that it gives us a tantalizing glimpse into the stresses and the mundane reality of the life of an evangelist, in this case, Paul. Now, Paul is contemplating the inevitability of his coming death. He lists his frustrations with those who have either left him, deserted him, wronged him, and it gives us a list of the things he wants: the warm cloak, the papers, the books. It's not quite the inspirational call to evangelism and to mission that we might expect today of all days. So even on his own day, Luke is central to the message, but not the focus. There is something wonderfully comforting to me about this unassuming presence of Luke that encourages me to be more of an evangelist than other models of ministry that we might find in either the Bible or in the church past or present. It is telling that so central and so important a disciple as Luke is described by the New Testament biographer,
Ronald Brandrig as the loyal and indefatigable secretary, doctor, and companion of the Apostle Paul. He's not defined as the writer or the physician, he's defined in relationship to Paul. Luke's double act with Paul is all the more interesting as he's quite the opposite of Paul. Rather than being at the head of the mission, it is Luke who provides the strength, the support, the stamina. And not just for Paul, but for us today who read the Gospel and the Book of Acts and get that same strength and support from Luke. We draw near to the good news of Jesus through the Gospel and through the Acts of the Apostles. Given the importance of Luke in the task of evangelism, first in his travels with Paul, and now through the gift of his gospel text to us, it seems right that we use his feast day to think through how we, in our turn, might be messengers of the gospel. The church provides for us today in the gospel reading Luke's account of the Great Commission, not just the 12 disciples, but of 70 or 72 others, sent out in pairs to every town and every place. We have practical advice, not to be weighed down by possessions. Leave your bags or purses, just take one pair of shoes. Don't be distracted on the way by conversations, and stay where you are welcome. Bring peace, speak peace, leave peace. It's as simple as that. But before these tips, these words of advice that Jesus gives, he says something which is, I think, key to how we might dare to consider ourselves to be evangelists. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs in the midst of wolves. Undoubtedly, this command could be taken to be interpreted in two different ways, and I expect it's intended to be understood in two ways. The most obvious, or perhaps the most apparent reading, is that the world can be a very hostile place. It feels at times as if we are like lambs going into the midst of wolves. Certainly for those proclaiming the kingdom as radical, countercultural, and as challenging to the authorities as the kingdom of God made visible in Jesus Christ should be, then yes, it is like going into the midst of wolves. And the persecution of followers of Christ was known to Luke. His journeys with Paul will have taught him about the dangers of proclaiming the gospel. Proclaiming the gospel to those who have been hardened by selfishness, greed, and a love of power. Christianity, by its nature, threatens the hierarchy and the hegemony, or at least it ought to. It is certainly into this lupine world that the Christian treads with the vulnerability of a lamb. But this vulnerability is not the timidity of hiding or the fearfulness of the world. This framing of the missionary or the evangelist as a lamb is a reminder of that prophecy of Isaiah. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the young goat. The Christian must hold together these two models of lamb leadership, the sacrificial vulnerability and the gentleness, the peacefulness, the confidence that comes from having the knowledge of being deeply loved, being the beloved, to borrow words from St. John. Because when we know that we are loved, we are free to be ourselves, and we witness to the glory of the God who loves us. As we celebrate this feast of Luke as physician and evangelist, we hold these two roles together. Salvation is the ultimate pinnacle of healing, the salve of our souls, the redemption, fulfillment, and culmination of our life in Christ. The proclamation of this knowledge of salvation, which is the knowledge of God's deep, deep love for us, is the work of an evangelist. It is your work, and it is my work. Evangelist is not a title which many of us would naturally claim, and yet, when we speak peace, we speak God. When we speak healing, we speak Christ. When we speak reconciliation, we speak the Holy Spirit. St. Luke's influence on the missionary nature of the church is huge, through his travels with Paul and his sacred writings, and yet he does not place himself centrally. But through his quiet presence, assured that he is known and loved by God, so he proclaims the good news of the kingdom. This is the best type of evangelism, a presence which spreads joy and encourages others to find freedom in Christ. How different this is from the evangelism which rides roughshod over personal encounter. How different it is from the whirlwind of activity that we might think is implied by a call to evangelism. Whilst we might not warm to the cautionary words of the Dean 100 years ago who said there was nothing to do and nothing that ever needed doing, we do well to still and steady ourselves. Evangelism is most attractive when we see contentment and peace and hope in the life of the believer. Go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. Dear friends, do not be fearful of the world, frightened into timidity, but go on your way. Be that lamb who courageously models a different way, the way of Christ, who is the Lamb of God, the way of love and joy and peace.
Let us stand to affirm our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
Father, you sent your Son to show your love to the world, and called the evangelist St. Luke to proclaim that good news. Give your servants boldness to make known the gospel and raise up new bearers of your truth in every generation. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
Father, through your Son you have taught us that in your kingdom the fast shall be last and the last fast. Bring in your kingdom of justice and peace in our days. Heal the violence in Armenia, Azerbaijan, Afghanistan. Bring reconciliation in America, Hong Kong, and Thailand, and give all your children the hope of a world transformed. Lord, hear us.
Lord.
Son called those who obeyed him his brother and sister and mother, and gave himself up for their sake. Help us to make cheerfully the sacrifices asked of us on behalf of our brothers and sisters, in this college, university, city, and country, especially at this time of need. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
Father, your Son healed the sick and sent our disciples to continue his healing work. As we remember the life and witness of the physician St. Luke, we pray for all who work in medical roles, whether clinical, caring, or research. Restore to health and joy those whom they tend, and make us all bearers of your healing forgiveness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, gracious, hear us.
Father, your Son promised that those who followed him would share the banquet of the kingdom. Unite us with all who have shared this earthly feast before us, and bring the departed into your heavenly peace, to share your eternal praises with St. Luke and all the saints. Lord, hear us.
Lord,
rejoicing in our communion with our Blessed Mother, St. John the Baptist, St. Luke, and all the saints, let us offer our own petitions in a moment of silence.
Hasten, Lord, the day when people will come from east and west, from north and south, to sit at table in your kingdom, and we shall see your Son in his glory. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Could you stand, please? We are fellow citizens with the saints in the household of God, through Christ our Lord, who came and preached peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please be seated. Last week we were able to welcome our freshers to the college. This evening it's a very great pleasure to welcome the new members of the college choir. So I'd like to ask new members to stand, please, and to remove their face coverings so that you can see them. We're hugely privileged to be blessed with such wonderful music, enriching our liturgy on Sundays and through the weeks. We're delighted to have you with us, and we welcome you to the choir. Please join me in welcoming them. Pages 16 and 17 of the booklets, you'll find the list of services for this week and also some notices. If you'd like to join us for one of the choral services on Tuesday, Wednesday or Thursday, or Ben Nicholas's organ recital at lunchtime on Thursday, then please do use the booking system to book a place. And if you'd like to find out more about Mel's book group, which is running this term, then have a word with her after the service. This evening, when it comes to the time for Holy Communion, everyone is most welcome to come forward. If you normally receive communion, you're very welcome to do so here, or if you prefer, come forward for a blessing. Communion will be administered in one kind, and you'll see some instructions about the administration in the booklet. Please follow the directions of the stewards. We remain seated now as the choir sings the offertory motet.
Thank you. indeed right and good, that we should give you thanks, praise, and glory. Almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. For after his resurrection, he sent out his apostles and evangelists to preach the gospel to all nations and lead us in the way of truth. Himself, the chief cornerstone, he founded his church upon the apostles, firmly to stand forever as a sign of your holiness on earth, and a living witness to all of the way that leads to salvation. And so with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we lift our voices and join in their unending hymn of praise.
Of all holiness, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of Blessed Mary, John the Baptist, Luke, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Strengthened by our communion with all the saints, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. God's holy gifts, for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy, Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The body and blood of Christ. Let us pray. Lord God, keep us faithful to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, united in prayer and the breaking of bread, and one in joy and simplicity of heart, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.